Good morning, Dr. Gautam Chattopadhyay. Warm welcome to you on this auspicious occasion. Small introduction about Dr. Chattopadhyay. Dr. Chattopadhyay is a senior scientist at the NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, California Institute of Technology. A visiting professor at the Division of Physics, Mathematics, and Astronomy at the California Institute of Technology, Pasadena, USA. A Bell Distinguished Chair Professor at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and an adjunct professor at the IIT Kharagpur. He is our alumnus of the Electronics Department of 1987 batch. Dr. Chattopadhyay received his PhD degree in Electrical Engineering from Caltech in 2000, and is currently a fellow of IEEE USA, IETE India, and an IEEE Distinguished Lecturer. His research interests include microwave, millimeter wave, and terahertz receiver systems, high frequency radars, and development of space instruments for the search of life beyond the Earth. He has more than 350 publications in international journals and conferences and holds more than 20 patents. He has received more than 35 NASA Technical Achievement and New Technology Invention Awards. He received the IEEE Region 6 Engineer of the Year Award in 2018, Distinguished Alumni Award from IIST Shippur in 2017. He was the recipient of the Best Journal Paper Award in 2020 and 2013 by IEEE Transaction on Terahertz Science and Technology. I request Dr. Chattopadhyay to start his lecture, and it's over to you.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to wish all of you a good evening, good morning, and good afternoon, wherever you are. I know people are joining in from all over the world, and that shows that we are in a connected world now. We can have this kind of events because of the technologies that people have developed. So I will actually share my screen and show some slides, but the basic idea of that will be to have some interaction. I'll give some talk, and so let me do that. Let's see if I can share. So you can see my screen. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's okay, thank you. Visible. So again, so I'm very excited to talk to you all. As it was mentioned, that I am actually an alumni of BE College. At that time, it used to be called BE College. And I'm so happy to be here for the 80th anniversary of the Metallurgy Department. So when I joined BE College in 1983, I did not have much idea about metallurgy, to be honest. But at the time, the principal was Professor Shill. And he is one of the stalwarts in metallurgy. And that's when we came to know about metallurgy. My background is electronics and telecommunication engineering from BE College. So I'm not going to talk about metallurgy, I can assure you that, because I don't know anything about it. But metallurgy is very important subject, because if you even look at space for NASA, a lot of material developments that we do, that we need to do, it comes from expertise in the metallurgical sector. So it is a very, very important field, not only in daily industrial life, but also for space applications as well. So what I'm going to talk about is this question that we have, that are we alone in this universe? That does life exist outside our planet Earth? This is the fundamental question that drives all the technology that we develop in NASA. So let's see what I think about it and what NASA thinks about it and where we are in that journey. So before I start, I want to acknowledge the people that I work with. We have a small group of people, about 24 that we develop certain kind of technology that is very high frequency terahertz technology. Our aim is to develop instrumentation to answer those kind of questions. If you look at the faces of all these people, you will realize that they come from all over the world. So that's what one main aspect of NASA is, that you know, we have huge diversity in our workforce. The people from all over the world, they want to come and work here. And I am so lucky to get this opportunity to work with people who are so smart. They're the best of the best from all across the globe. And a little bit about NASA and JPL. NASA actually has different laboratories all across the United States. Our headquarters is in Washington, D.C. And then I am here in Pasadena, California. That is Jet Propulsion Laboratory. That's where I work. JPL is the largest NASA lab, and we focus on robotic missions. We all know that NASA is going to launch the Perseverance rover to Mars on July 30th, and it was built here in our lab. So a lot of people have been working on that tirelessly, even under the COVID situation. And so that's what we are looking forward to that. So this is what we do. If you, many of you know about Johnson Space Center, because that's in Houston. If you have watched the movie, Apollo 13, Houston, you have a problem because all manned missions are controlled from Houston, but non-manned robotic missions are all controlled and done mostly from JPL. So let's start. We all know that actually our universe started with the Big Bang. This is the Big Bang theory. This is not the Big Bang theory that you watch on TV. So this is the real one. And the current age of the universe is about 13.85 billion years. So that's where we are here at the top, and it started with the Big Bang. And it turns out that we did not have, if you can study the history of this universe, how all these things came about using electromagnetics. Basically, all this light that comes out. Light is electromagnetics. Your phone, everyone has a smartphone. Your smartphone, the way the communication works is through electromagnetics. So if you want to study the history of our universe, you can actually go back in time and look at it through those lens, that is the lens of electromagnetics, the radiations, and we can go only back up to about 400,000 years after Big Bang, because that's when the first light came out. It's called cosmic microwave background signal. And then if we have to go back to before that, we actually use other means to study. So, okay, if we ask you this question, that are we alone in this universe, what will be your answer? My answer is that I believe that we are not alone in this universe, that there is life somewhere else. But let me set the stage, set at the beginning, that so far, whatever you read on YouTube and on internet, we have not found life anywhere outside our planet Earth, any form of life. We have not found anything yet. But that does not mean it cannot exist. And why do I believe that way? The reason is, if you look, when you look in a clear sky, dark sky, if you look in the sky, you will find that all the stars, glittering stars, right? And we have about 100 billion stars in our galaxy, own galaxy, that is the Milky Way galaxy. We have about 100 billion, that is about 11 zeros after one, that gives you 100 billion. And it turns out there are about 100 billion galaxies in our universe as well, which means there are about, roughly order of magnitude, 10 to the power 22 to 10 to the power 23 stars in our universe. If then think about, do your probabilistic calculation, we are finding that majority of these stars has planets. And also they have multiple planets, not like one, like our own sun, there are multiple planets out there. And then what is the probability of finding one such planet where the conditions are such that life can exist? if you do your probabilistic calculations, that number is finite. It is not non-zero number. So only thing that we'll have to find that. We'll have to find, and it's not easy to find that. One of the things that, as I mentioned, that we are actually going back to Mars, and we are, you know that earlier this week, UAE launched a mission to Mars, HOPE mission, HOPE 1, and then today, China launched a mission to Mars. India has a Mangalyaan mission already, and we're planning for Mangalyaan 2. We have gone to, from NASA, we have gone to Mars several times. We are going again. Why do we go back to Mars time and again? The reason is that, you know, Mars in its earlier history resembled very much like planet Earth. So the question is, was Mars ever habitable? Was there life on Mars at any point of time? We have not found life on Mars yet, but was there life at any point of time? So that's one of the reasons we keep going back. If I show you this picture and tell you that this is actually one of the roads in Shippur during rainy season now. No, I'm not kidding. I'm kidding. It's not the case. This picture is actually from Mars. And if you pay close attention to this picture, what you'll realize that the terrain, this kind of terrain we get only when there is flowing water. But if you go to Mars now, you don't see flowing water. The question is, what happened? Where did that water go? Can it happen to our own Earth, own planet? And what do we do about it? So these are the big questions that all the scientists and engineers, and as a citizenry, will have to think about. And that's one of the reasons we actually keep going back to do all this exploration. And then we have been building a lot of rovers to land. You know that we started with a very small Pathfinder that landed in 1996. And then Spirit and Opportunity dual rovers in 2003, Curiosity 2011, now Perseverance 2020. So we are building all this, and we are getting better and better in building this kind of instruments. But I want to tell you one thing, that it is not really easy to land on Mars. It is extremely challenging, and that's one of the reasons that other than the United States, no other countries has been successful in landing something on Mars. It's not that they didn't try or they're not smart. It's because it is too difficult. And so it is not routine. So every mission is extremely challenging. So we are keeping our fingers crossed for Perseverance mission. So this is what the Perseverance mission, the rover, is going to look like. You can see there are a lot of instruments. My work is actually not building the rover. I'm not a mechanical engineer or a robotics engineer. I am an electronics engineer. So I actually build this instrument that goes on these rovers. So we build instruments to do the science, to get the science returns. So you can see there are a lot of different instruments. It has a drill that will drill hole on Martian rock and do some spectroscopic experiments. So we have cameras. So there are 23 total cameras, and about seven of them are science cameras. So this is very exciting, and I'll show you a picture, latest picture of this is Perseverance rover ready. You can see in our lab here that was all put together. So it is right now in Cape Canaveral in Florida and getting ready for launch on July 30th. So we are very, very excited about that. So I want to show you this picture. Actually, this picture was taken by our previous rover, Curiosity, and this was taken from the surface of Mars. And if what you see here, I don't know whether the quality of the screen is good enough on your, on your end, you can see a dot, small dot, that is Earth, and if you expand it, you will see Earth and the Moon. So this was the first time our planet was captured from the surface of another planet. So that is very, very exciting. So if you think about it, if you are an engineer and if you actually build something like this, and then that goes to another planet and takes a picture for own Earth, that is so exhilarating. So that's what makes it all worth. And one of the reason I also show this picture, particularly for students, is because, you know, sometimes we think that we are very smart, and you are, you all are very smart, I'm sure. But we actually get a little bit of egotistic. We think we know everything. But next time you start thinking that way, you should think about this picture, because in the big scheme of thing, we are just a dot in the sky. So we are not that big that we think we are. And hopefully that thought will ground you. And I always tell, for electrical engineers, grounding is very, very important. So let's get to it, that how, where are these exoplanets? Exoplanets are planets that we are finding in the outer world, not in our own sun, solar system. So these are all planets that we have so far found about 4,200 total number of exoplanets. And you will find that the distribution of their sizes are all over the place, you know, all different sizes. Many of, majority of them are gaseous planets like Jupiter. So we don't think we can have life. But if you look at many, they are like Earth size and in the habitable zone. Habitable zone is where the conditions of these planets are such that the temperature is such that the water can exist on the surface in the liquid form. And we know the kind of life that we know, they need water and oxygen. So the carbon-based life. So we actually look for those in the planets. Is there water? Is there possibility of water? Is there possibility of an atmosphere? Is there possibility to have oxygen? So this is what we actually look for. And if you ask me that, I said then a billions, 10 to the 22, 10 to the 23 number of stars, then why we have found only 4,000 planets? The reason is, if you look at, this is our Milky Way galaxy, how fast this one galaxy is, and we have looked only one small area of our galaxy. That's because of the limitation of our technology. And so we are spending more effort and more money to develop new technology so that we can actually look at these kind of more and more planets. And I'll give you an example, like one of the planets, that planetary system we found, where we believe there's a possibility of life, is at 40 light years away. If you ask me, okay, what is the distance of 40 light years and how much time it will take for our, with our current technology, it will take about 40 million years to reach there. So we are not going to go to those planets anytime soon. So we'll have to learn from about those sitting in here and try to find out, you know, all the things that we can. So we need to build instruments to do that. And that's why we need all of you, all the people who are listening in, all the students and, you know, researchers who are listening in. We need you. We need your help to actually accomplish that. So how do you find the planets? It's very, very challenging, because what happens is, if a, you know, we are sitting at our planet Earth, and if a planet is going around their star like this, then we won't be able to detect that planet on the left side. But if you look at the right side, if the planet is in our, you know, line of sight against the star, then we can detect. What happens is that we try to isolate that star and try to measure the total amount of light that is coming from that star. And as the planet actually moves in front of the star, the amount of light ever slightly dims. By measuring with a very sensitive instrument, that dimming of the light from that a particular star gives us the clue that there is a planet. And then from that studies, and by studying the gravity and everything, we can, you know, deduce a lot of things. What is the size? What is the density of that planet? Because you can do, you know, gravitational calculations, and then you can see, is it a rocky planet or is it a gaseous planet? And how, what is the period of that, you know, planetary body? So all those things we can actually deduce by this kind of measurements, and that's what we do. There is another kind of measurements we do, that two techniques. It's called actually Doppler radial shift, because what happens is, as the, if you look at the frequency that is coming in from a star, and as the planet goes close and away from that star, because of the Doppler effect, the frequency changes ever slightly. By measuring the change of frequency, we'll be able to tell is there any planet or not. So this is, these are the techniques that we use to actually find planets. And okay, I was talking to you about, you know, finding water, because water is one of the key ingredients for life. So the question is there enough water out there in the universe to sustain life? The answer is yes. How? Because we are finding that from, you know, new sun-like star, water is coming out as bullets in a very high speed. What is the speed? 200,000 kilometers per hour. If you fire a bullet from an AK-47 rifle, not that I will suggest that you do, the speed of this bullet is about 2,500 kilometers per hour. So these water molecules are traveling 80 times faster than a bullet. But, you know, if something travels that fast, it, you know, because of friction, it generates a lot of heat. It tries to destroy itself. You know, it reaches temperature 100,000 degrees. However, it finds a way to recombine and create huge amount of water. How much? About 100 million times the total amount of water in the Amazon River is formed per second in one of these stars, which means we are flooded with water in this universe. There's a huge amount of water out there. That means, yes, now we'll have to find out, you know, oxygen and water, is there life? So that's what we'll have to do. Another thing that we also are very much curious about, that we actually do try to understand, is how did water come to planet Earth? Because when planet Earth was formed, there's no water. And scientists believe that the comets brought water to Earth. Actually, I am building some, I'll show you in my instrumentation part, that I'm building instruments to find out, did really answer that question, did really comets bring water to Earth? If we can answer this kind of question, then you'll be able to actually deduce more about other planets, how the water is coming there. So these are very fundamental questions we are trying to answer by building instruments. And we are talking about life in, you know, exoplanets, that is millions and billions of miles away. So what about our own solar system? Is there life outside our Earth, in our own solar system? Is there a possibility? There could be, because if we look at this, this is the picture of Enceladus. Enceladus is a moon of Saturn. And using an instrument that we built in our laboratory, actually I was involved in building this instrument, Hi-Fi instrument in Herschel Space Observatory, we found that Enceladus is raining water out. So we looked at it and we found the water coming out from Enceladus. This is a very cold, you know, icy moon. Then how come water is there inside in the liquid form? It can be if there is a source of energy. So if there is source of energy, if there is water, can there be life? So we are actually planning a mission to Enceladus. It has not been finalized, but we are trying to build instruments to look for what else is coming out from there. Is there organic materials? Is there any life materials? So that is one of the questions that we'll want to answer, and for that we are building instruments. Another planetary body where there could be life, actually there's a NASA has a mission planned already, that is Europa. Europa is a moon of Jupiter. Again, this is a very cold body, icy body, and we have thick ice on Europa. However, we believe there is a water ocean underneath this icy, thick ice shell. And there is water is liquid, which means there is a mantle, like our own Earth, that produces heat. So that's what keeps it liquid form. But the thickness of this ice shell, we think, is about 15 kilometers to 100 kilometers. So if NASA comes to you and says, you know, we are planning a mission to Europa to find out if the ocean, the Europa's ocean, has life. So what kind of instrument you are going to build to find out if there's life there? So, of course, the obvious answer is that we send a drill a hole, lower a bucket and see if there is any fish. Okay, I like fish. That's why I give the fish analogy. We all Bengalis like fish. So, but problem is that when we actually build an instrument, total amount of power, the DC power we have for this kind of mission is only about 300 watts, 300 to 400 watts, 3 to 4 light bulb. That's all we have. So we cannot have a drill that can drill, you know, through ice about 15 to 100 kilometers. So we'll have to find other ways to find out. So we are actually actually building instrument to do that, because it turns out there are a lot of cracks in this ice shell and the materials come all the way to the top. And since Jupiter, Europa is very close to Jupiter, Jupiter has very high magnetic field. That means high radiation environment that puts all the material in the space, and we can build instrument to actually see if there's any organic materials. Organic materials does not necessarily mean life, but it means that possibility of life. So we are actually building instrument for that to go to Europa. That will happen soon. So, okay, those are the science thing that actually drives to answer this question. So what kind of technology we need to develop to make that happen, to actually understand if there is life in all those exoplanets? One of the things that we'll have to do is miniaturize. For space, everything is about making things small, making things more energy efficient so that it needs less power. And we are actually very good at making things small. I can tell you, because look at this. This one is the first IC that we built in 1960, had 3 to 4 transistors only, right? Then Intel 1101 chip, we had 2000 transistors. This is 1969. And then look at this, NVIDIA, we have 7 billion transistors. So we are getting really better miniaturizing this thing. Now, right now we are producing about 10 to the power 19 transistors per year. That is about 1000 transistors for every ant on this planet Earth. I don't know why I gave you these statistics, but anyway, so most of these transistors, they work. So we are getting better, but that is not enough. That, because cheap is only one thing. Like you have, if you look at this, this is a 1 megawatt instrument in 1917, how big this is, because you need to put a system together. Only one chip does not work well. But if you look at this one, if you top right of the screen, what you see, you know what that is? That is actually iPhone 5. Circuit board. If you have not opened your smartphone yet, you should open it and see. I opened my wife's iPhone. Oh, that's why it had water jam. That's why I opened. But you'll see that, you know, the way we build things with different chips and packaging, this is very, very important. And we are actually trying to do, I am building instrument for planetary exploration using this kind of technology, iPhone technology, so that it's really very tiny, very compact, and draws less amount of power. So that's where challenge is. One of the things we are also doing, building CubeSat. CubeSat are small shoebox-sized satellites so that we can much cheaper. You know, one big satellite costs billions of dollars. Instead, if we can build very small satellites, and of course, we have to compromise a little bit on the performance, but if we build that kind of instrument, then we can build many of them and send. So that's what we are doing. You know, there are already a lot of CubeSats out there, but we are building more. So recently we did something called Mars, because when something goes to Mars, we cannot have any communication as the spacecraft is going in the atmosphere of Mars for 7-8 minutes, because there is no direct link to Earth. So we actually built some shoebox satellites called Marco to act as a relay, basically from the spacecraft was going down, the inside spacecraft, and it relayed signal about the health, how things are going to this CubeSat, and the CubeSat send the information back. It takes 7 minutes for signal to arrive from Mars to Earth because of the distance involved. So we actually, otherwise you wouldn't have known what is going on, whether the health of the spacecraft as it going down. So another thing we are doing, actually, this is a radar that we built on a CubeSat. Again, this is shoebox size, 30 centimeter by 20 centimeter by 10 centimeter. But we developed some antenna technology that is deploying antennas. It can deploy a 50 centimeter antenna. This is a radar instrument that we built for Earth observation. So, but the innovation was, how can you make a large antenna that fits in a very small volume? So we are getting really better. Like, this is the actual antenna. I know many of you are metallurgists. You don't work on antennas, but the material that was used here, this on the mesh, had a lot of input from material science side. So we need everyone. When we work for NASA, one discipline is not enough. We need people from all walks of life: mechanical, electronics, scientists, metallurgists, so material science everywhere. So that's what I keep telling people, that come and join us because we need all of you. So I'll show you this example, how we actually build this antenna. It looks cool. So if you look at, if I click the video, I don't know how the video will work or not on this format. Let's try. So if you click on this, you can see this is how it actually deploys. This is a spring-loaded system. So we click on it and slowly the antenna deploys. That's how it deploys, and then there is a secondary antenna that you also. So this is how we do that, because we'll have to miniaturize, we'll have to package it well so that it works well. So we are building many other kind of antennas for larger and larger antenna that can be folded and kept in a very small compact size. And we are also building antennas which are flat. This is again some material science experiments, because we made this antenna using 3D printing. This is all metal 3D printing antenna. The thickness, height of this antenna is just about a millimeter. So kind of skin that goes on the sidewall of a spacecraft and makes it an antenna. So that is very exciting new work that we have done. We have patents on that. And it actually, I am building instruments, as I said, that actually will be using this kind of antennas. So one of the instruments that I'm building is, I mentioned, to go to a comet, trying to find out that did those comets brought water to Earth. And we have made a lot of progress in that. And you can see different antennas and the different kind of packaging thing that we did. And this is the instrument that it looks like. So we had slightly bigger instrument, and now we are able to miniaturize that. This entire instrument weighs less than 2 kilograms and draws less than 5 watts. You know, 5 watts power is really tiny amount of power, but we are able to do that, and it will be able to tell us whether the comets brought water to Earth. So you can see that how much water has to go in to come here on your left of the screen that you can see. This is an entire spectrometer instrument working at 500 to 600 gigahertz. You know, you talk about 5G, 4G technologies. 5G, I actually work in Keller's frequencies that is much beyond 5G. So I have worked in Keller's frequencies for a long time. So, you know, what you see 5G, I have some contributions there. So I will end with the final two slides, because you all know that for this Perseverance mission, that rover to Mars, we also have a helicopter called Ingenuity. And then why we are sending a helicopter to Mars? The reason is that if you look at the rover, as I said, it takes about 7 minutes for signal to go. We cannot drive the rover sitting here, you know, because it will take 7 minutes to reach the signal to them. So we'll have to actually upload things up front. And then we find a lot of, you know, new things when you go there. But rover cannot go everywhere. So what we are doing is that send a helicopter. Helicopter will take off, will go around. It has cameras, it has all the sensors on it. It will send the signal back to the rover, and then the rover can go there and find if there is anything interesting. So if you think, what is the big deal about sending a rover to a helicopter to Mars? The big deal is that, you know, Mars is much lighter atmosphere compared to our planet Earth. As a result, when you have a helicopter, the rotor of the helicopter rotates 400 to 600 RPM revolution per minute. But on the Mars, we need about 2,600. You know, revolution per minute. So it's much, much challenging, much, much difficult. And how do you power a very small, tiny thing? So we have come up with, you know, low power system, but it will go there, take all the signals, come back and recharge again. So we are, and we had to design antennas on that. So we had, this is really, really challenging. And then I want to end with this picture, that this is the Mars helicopter Ingenuity that is ready, and it has been integrated on Mars rover in Perseverance, and it's ready on the launch pad. We are going to launch it on 30th of July. And I want to end with that. That is very, very exciting time to be a space scientist. And I will urge all of you, because we need help. You know, NASA has an open arm policy. We take people from all across the globe, as I mentioned. So if you are interested, look, go to nasa.gov website and see what excites you and come and join us. Thank you very much. I'll be more than happy to take questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation, such a very lively presentation, in fact. I will now ask Rhythm to address the questions that have come up. Over to you, Rhythm.
Thank you, sir, for your session. We have quite a few questions for you now. Sir, the first question is, Voyager 1 and 2 still sends signals to Earth. However, it has gone to outer space far beyond Sun. Then how it sends the signals?
Yes, that's a very good question. Yes, so Voyager 1 actually has gone outside our own solar system. It has very tiny amount of power, right? So when we get very annoyed when I'm watching a YouTube video on our smartphone and it starts rotating because the download data is not much, if you think about it, what happens to Voyager is cannot send a very high data rate signal. It's about a couple of bits per second it can send. Because of the battery, it has actually battery that is a RTG. RTG is actually nuclear powered battery because there is no, this is not solar powered. Sunlight doesn't reach there. So it has RTG batteries, but again, it has been going for so long that power is not that much. So that's why it can send only very little bit of information. It cannot send pictures. It can just send some couple of bits telling the health of this spacecraft and say, yes, I'm still here. So that kind of thing it does. It cannot send a lot of data.
Thank you, sir. Over to our next question. As a motive for the Artemis program, the moon is expected to play an important role as a launch pad for future interplanar visits. Please enlighten us more about this.
So, yeah, Artemis project. We have gone to moon, right? Moon is not a habitable place. We all know that. You know, that's not, we cannot go and, you know, colonize moon and live there. Why would you do that? Our planet Earth is much better place in that way, as long as we can keep it safe. However, one of the reasons we want to go to moon, because if you think about sending people to Mars or beyond, current technology that we have, we can send people to Mars today, but we cannot bring them back safely. That's one of the, you know, challenges that we have. But we believe that if you are actually outside our Earth's gravitational system, then it will get much easier because the amount of fuel that we need, it will be much less if you are, because to get out of Earth's gravity actually is one of the major challenges, and you spend a lot of fuel in that itself. So the approach that we are taking now for moon is different than what used to do before. You know, all Apollo programs was to actually go directly to moon, but here, if we can make Artemis project, that if you can make a kind of a space station kind of environment around moon. And then what will happen is the astronauts or people or this spacecraft can go there, you know, park yourself. And then if you want to go and study moon, you can go down to moon surface. But the Artemis will play as kind of a gateway to that. It's kind of an ISS, International Space Station, but that is around moon. So that's what the concept is, that we'll be able to do experiments, you know, that also, you know, how much time it will take. It takes 7 months to go to Mars and 7 months to, if you can come back, it will take another 7 months. This is a huge amount of long journey. So for what is the effect of health on the astronauts and everyone on that kind of environment? So we'll be studying those things through this. That's why we are creating what you call a gateway to moon. And we are asking help from the private industry as well to actually provide infrastructure so that we can, you know, move forward on that. That's what the plan is for Artemis.
Thank you, sir. Over to our next question. There is a star that shows unusually peculiar more drops in intensity. So can there be a possibility of a Dyson sphere and advanced civilization? If that is the case, then how can we contact them? Just a hypothesis.
So we don't know. To be honest, that there are, you know, every day we are finding. So we have a theory, right, that when we do some measurements, we see, observe something, and then we try to come up with a theory which fits our observation. But we are finding the newer, new, you know, discoveries and new kind of star that actually does not fit our existing theory. So we'll have to then, you know, come up with a what can make that kind of star. And right now, there's absolutely no indication that there is any advanced, you know, that civilization or anything anywhere. Absolutely not. You know, like by looking at a just star and it's dimming, we won't be able to tell. There is, because we are all scientists and engineers, we need real proof, right? So what is the real proof? Where is the real proof that exact that they are sending some signal or there is some advanced civilization? There could be, we don't know, but there is no, we do not have any proof. So to contact, if there is any, there is a called SETI program, you know, search for extraterrestrial intelligence. So through that, we think that if there is an intelligent life out there, and if we sense something in some kind of binary code, like we suppose someone is out there and that's sending signal to us to contact us, how will you know, right? So one way to know that if there is a pattern to a signal that is not coming from a natural source. So that's why with that thing in mind, we actually keep sending signals and also we keep listening in that if anyone is trying to contact us. We have not been contacted by anyone and we don't know whether we have reached anyone yet. So that's the unfortunate we'll come to know in future.
Thank you, sir. Over to our next question. The next question is, sir, how did you get to the University of California? Did you appear in GRD or any other process? And what are the basic skills required for that?
So I actually didn't go to University of California. I came to California Institute of Technology. University of California, Los Angeles is very close to my home. University of California system has a lot of 11 campuses. That's one of the largest UC system, University of California system. This is a state university. But I went to Caltech. Caltech is California Institute of Technology is actually a very small university, only 2,000 students. Of that, 900 is undergraduate and 1,100 are graduate, master's and PhD students. There are about 300 faculties. 42 people got Nobel Prize from Caltech. So it is amazing. This ranked number one in the university in the world multiple times. If any time, you can find it in top five university in the world. It's an amazing place. So how I came here, it is a good question, because you all know that I actually did my undergraduate from BE College, and then I worked a couple of years in TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. In Pune, they have a center called NCRA now, National Center for Radio Astrophysics. That's where I worked and built a radio telescope called GMRT, Giant Microwave Radio Telescope. And then I applied to come to US to do my master's. I did my master's from University of Virginia, and then I applied to Caltech, just took a chance, and I was lucky that they selected me and I came here. Yes, you need to take GRE and TOEFL, and the key for applications these good universities in the US for your master's or PhD is that, of course, you'll have to have good grades, you'll have to study well, you'll have to know the subject matter well, you know, from your applications, we can find out that, you know, whether you have done well or not, if you should do some projects that help, if you can write some papers when you are undergraduate, publish some paper, that also help. And then you need very good recommendation letters from people who have directly worked with you. You know, we have a tendency of writing letters that, okay, he bears good moral character, it's important, but that is not what I'm looking for. What we are looking for is, you know, does this person has direct knowledge about the candidate, that, okay, this person has really these skills, they have worked well in a team. So those are the things we look for. And also something called SOP, statement of purpose, that why you want to come and what you want to do and what prepared you to do that. So that is, you have to write an essay, that is very important as well.
Thank you, sir. Over to our next question. What are your views and possibilities of mining asteroids in space?
This, you know, this question people ask, you know, first look at the mining in our own, you know, IIEST has a good mining department. My brother is actually a mining engineer from IIB College. So mining on our planet Earth itself is very, very difficult. Think about go to an asteroid, go to another, you know, some planetary body and try to mine it. It is extremely challenging. This exciting, but extremely challenging. I don't think we have that technology to go to another asteroid and mine, and we don't know what we are going to get. Yes, as I said, it's exciting, but we are not really focusing on that.
Thank you, sir. Over to our next question. What is the upcoming role of a material scientist in space industries, mainly in NASA?
So as I mentioned, you know, material science is one of the very important areas of research nowadays, because if you look around, you know, spacecraft, as I mentioned, the instrument side, I don't know, also the spacecraft side, because it goes through all the spacecraft, it goes through so harsh environment. Look at, you know, our space shuttle program that we had, that actually lost Challenger, we lost two space shuttles because of some faults. And think about it, when it's entering our atmosphere, re-entering our atmosphere, it generates so much heat, and the styes that was on the side of the, you know, space shuttle, these are all materials science. So we are looking for new materials, new kind of materials, which can actually withstand heat, we can withstand pressure, and all the time. So, and even if for the from the instrument side, we are looking for new materials. Can we have some material that can have properties, can sensing properties? Can we use them for sensing purposes? So all kinds, all across of life, material science actually goes hand in hand with all other technology development. Think about your, you know, again, going back to everyone a smartphone. So look at your smartphone and open it. Now, how much material science research has gone in for the silicon technology that allows you to do all this stuff today that we are doing? Where did that come from? Material science research. So material science has a lot of role to play, not only everyday life, and of course for NASA as well.
Thank you, sir. We still have quite a few questions. So over to our next question. Is the exploration on Mars limited to the site which receives sunlight?
You know, Mars actually receives sunlight everywhere, not like Moon. If you think about it, Moon is actually tidally locked to Earth, which means that we always see the same side of the Moon. It does not mean that sunlight doesn't reach there, because, you know, the Sun rotates around, Moon rotates around, our Earth is rotating around, but we see only one face. That is not the case. So of course there are polar regions which are, you know, there is some temperature differences and all. So we always, you know, scope out. We have other mission that is called orbiter mission that goes around Mars, and we scope it out where, what are the places could be interesting. Think about it. Suppose some aliens that you are talking about, we don't have aliens again, but suppose there were aliens and they came to Earth, they have an orbiter going around, they are deciding where to go, right? Which place to land to find out, will they land in, you know, Sahara Desert, or are they going to land in Kolkata? So, of course, Kolkata is a much more interesting place in many respects. So that's the kind of thing, right? We actually scope it out, we scout it out, and try to see scientifically which places will be more interesting, because we have limited number of dollars, limited number of missions, so we cannot really go everywhere. So we'll have to decide where will be more scientifically more valuable. That's how we decide a place to go to.
Thank you, sir. One of our participants asked, he says, I am in BE Mechanical. Can I join NASA? I have 8.5 years experience in this situation. In this situation, can I join NASA?
So thing is that to join NASA directly, from India or other countries as a staff member, as an engineer, as an employee, it is very difficult. The reason is that how do I know that you are good enough? People are applying, like you are asking whether you can join. We hear from people from Santiago, Chile. We get from, Cape Town, South Africa. So how do I know, whom do I take? Looking at your CV, looking at your experience, looking at a piece of paper, it is very difficult, right? So that is one of the challenges that we have. So I always tell the best path to come to NASA is if you come to the US for studying, do your master's, then you can actually apply because you are already here. Then we can interview you, we can come to us, and we can actually, we always want to see the person, COVID-19, because we cannot meet people, but otherwise, we want to see the person before we hire. We want to talk to them. The person will go around and meet many people. That is one of the way we can figure it out, whether that person is a good fit to our need or not. So that's what is challenging. But if you are a student, come as a student, master's or PhD student, that is one path. Another path is that if you already have done your PhD, then you can come apply as a postdoctoral fellow. NASA has a very good postdoctoral fellow program called NPP. You can go and check. It's called NASA postdoctoral program. And a lot of people come here to NPP after 2 years. And if we find them really good, we actually hire them. So these are the best two possible way to come to NASA. Directly from outside is not that I don't say that probability is zero, but it's very low, close to zero. To get direct hire from outside this way.
Our next question is, does the heating in the transistor chips create any problem?
Of course, that does, because that if you something is performing very high level, then heat is one of the major things. For our any space missions, thermal engineering is such a huge thing. I spend huge amount of time talking to the thermal people, because we have to, how do you actually take the heat out from your instrument, from your transistor, from your any other things? Because as you will find that if you are trying to build a very sensitive instrument, for whatever way you are doing your sensitive instrument that you're building, you'll find that heat plays a role, in the sense that heat will change. If the temperature changes, the performance of your instrument will change. So maintaining the good thermal environment, that is very important. So yes, thermal engineering is one of the key aspects of any, at least for NASA side.
Thank you, sir. One of our participants asked, she says, I am Shreyoshi Puttar of class 7. It is a great honor to know about space from you. What are light cones?
What is?
What
I didn't hear
light
the last part.
Cones.
Light
cones. Cones. C-O-N-E-S. Cones.
Life cones. L-I-F-E.
Light. L-I-G-H-T. Light.
Oh, light cones. Okay. So, yeah. First of all, thank you so much. I'm very glad that you are here. So you are, you are very smart, of course. And then, so you are listening in. I'm very glad that you are listening in. So yes, light cones are actually, think about it, that, light is coming out from, from all these stars, all these galaxies, it always come in a conical way. So, but, I want to tell you that since you are here, so think about always the big picture. Always you should try to think in terms of the basics of science, that how light works. Why light travels the way it travels? What are the properties of light? Because light is the electromagnetic energy, and then we can see it because that's particular frequency. But same electromagnetic the radiation can be of different frequencies as well. So it is very, very interesting phenomena. So my urge to you will be to actually study the fundamentals well. And keep a open mind. You can study anything that you want. And also, you are a girl. I want to tell you that do not think that you cannot do anything that you want, because you should always believe in yourself. Because boys and girls, they are equally good in doing everything. So never believe that you cannot do what you want to do. You can do whatever you want.
Thank you, sir. Our next question is, can we use nuclear fission power source or portable fusion source for drilling in Europa's ice sheet?
Okay, so you want to take nuclear resource and put drop there. You know, if there is any life, either radiation, that life will be gone, right? So we have polluted our environment enough, and you want to go to Europa and pollute there also. It is not easy. Of course, we are thinking of all kinds of different ways to find out. But you know, nuclear option is not a good option, because you know that has a lot of other side effects that you'll have to really care about. Because when you are actually going to another planetary body, one of the key thing is you'll have to think about planetary protection. If there is any life, we should not destroy that. Also, we should not take life from here and then detect that there, right? So these are the two things very important. So this is a good idea, but it's not a practical idea.
Thank you, sir, for being patient with us. We have just a few more questions left.
No problem, no problem at all.
The next question is, what is the truth about Area 51?
You know, I was wondering why there is no question about Area 51 yet. Also about moon landing, fake moon landing stuff, right? These are the two things that people keep asking me. So Area 51, I do not know much about Area 51. It's not too far from where I live, because that is in California. So that is actually a defense research area, and they do a lot of experiments. But I do not think that they are, making aliens out there and all those hanky-panky thing going on. Like any other research area, that they do a lot of experiments. So that's what it is.
Thank you, sir. Our next question is, given that most of the probes will be automated, how advanced is the current scenario of 4D printing in designing these probes?
The 3D printing you're talking about, I missed that word.
4D printing.
4D printing. I don't know what 4D printing is. So I know about, because you know, in terms of fourth dimension, generally you talk about time is a fourth dimension. So 3D additive manufacturing technique, 3D or 4D or 2D, whatever you want to call it. So additive manufacturing is actually very, very exciting, because we can do a lot of things that we could not do in our normal kind of machining and mechanical machining way. So we are NASA. We are looking at a lot of these 3D additive manufacturing and seeing that how we can use it. As I showed you one of the antennas I did with 3D manufacturing. So yes, so it is actually very field that we'll have to keep an eye on.
Okay, sir, only a couple of questions left. The next question is, during supernova, how was the energy released measured?
So basically it is when we measure something like, what is a supernova? Supernova is actually exploding star. What happens is that star has this nuclear source, right? Like our sun. And then what keeps it stable is that the radiation, that is the energy that is going out, and all the material, that the gravity, that is a balance, that's the equilibrium that keeps the star in balance. And then as the nuclear material starts depleting, as a result, there is an imbalance is created, that there are not enough radiation power that is keeping the balance with the gravitational force. And then the star collapses on itself, and then it actually explodes. That gives rise to the supernova. And then we measure, the thing is that most of the stars are not close to us. We actually measure the amount of energy. If you look at the star, amount of energy that we're measuring from a star, normal star, is how much? Tiny, right? So, but when we find that the supernova explosion, and then we measure much more power, but is not huge on planet Earth. So from there, we can actually deduce by comparison that how much power is being released. So that way we do, because again, we are not going to go and measure, you know, gigawatt, terawatt sense of power, scale of power. We actually measure tiny amount that comes here, but in comparison to a normal star, this is huge, and that's how we can tell how much power is released.
Okay, sir, over to our last question. Which type of communication device is used by macro spacecraft?
Yes, so, you know, there are various kind of communication protocol that we use. It all depends on, you know, what kind of power transmission we have. If you think about it, your communication, the major problem is, you know, power. That we need to have, you know, signal to noise. You have to create a, you know, that path. You know, you have to establish a channel, right? So to do that, you need to have at least good signal to noise. And to do that, in power comes the main way. Of course, we do a lot of kind of coding, a lot of kind of, you know, new techniques that is being used. But we are always limited by the power, because one of the way to address that is having huge antennas. But you cannot have a huge antenna on our spacecraft side. We have huge antenna on the ground, but we cannot have on the spacecraft. So different protocols that is used, we try to, you know, do, you know, to reduce data, we use all kinds of, you know, compression and everything. So we do not do, you know, CDMA or, you know, so we use mostly very simplistic, a reliable way of communication.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I want to wish you all good night.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Team Reminiscence is really grateful to you for sharing your vast knowledge with us and also answering so many questions. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, bye.
Bye, sir.